You have to forgive this cough. And I was very well until last Tuesday when we did the hearing in New York City. And by the end of the day, sitting for 7 hours, I think I get this backup of congestion. And by the end of the night, I had a full-blown cough. So I've been trying to nurse it, but it's almost impossible with the schedule that we keep. I thank you for your participation again. And Ms. Carla Palumbo has arrived. She is with the Rochester City Council, and she's also a staff member of Legal Aid of Rochester. And I would just like to ask her to come forward and give her testimony. Thank you, Ms. Palumbo.
Thank you, Senator. I do have written copies of my testimony here that I'll bring up unless somebody would like them now. Thank you. Thank you, Senator. I'd like to take this opportunity to actually thank you and express my appreciation for conducting and convening these hearings on this most important issue of IOLA funding and funding for civil legal services. As a practitioner in legal services, I'd also like to add my thanks to the Senate for the support that you've shown us over the years and the support that I know you're going to show us in the future. I'm glad to be able to be here today because I think I can bring a somewhat unique perspective to your deliberations. I've been an attorney at the Legal Aid Society of Rochester now since 1984. I'm currently the director of the Civil Division, and I still take cases. My primary area of practice is the representation of victims of domestic violence and matrimonial cases. I have seen and have the ability to see firsthand how the crisis that affects the crises affect our clients firsthand. I also have firsthand experience with our never-ending challenge to keep our agency and our programs fully funded. The other hat I wear, and I think the main reason for my being here today, is that of an elected official. I'm a member of the Rochester City Council. I represent the Northwest District of Rochester, which is probably one of the more challenged areas and houses some of the more challenged neighborhoods in our city. I'm incoming chair of the Neighborhood and Business Development Committee. And prior to my 2 years on City Council, I served on the Monroe County Legislature for 5 years and was minority leader for 2 years. So I know, both as a county legislator and a city council person, how many of the challenges that face our clients and many of the funding challenges that we as legislators and decisions that we have to make impact on the lives of the people in our community. Ensuring that the IOLA Fund remains on solid financial footing and that funding stays stable for legal services providers is good not only for the clients that they serve, but for the communities that benefit from their services. Legal services funding is one of the most cost-effective ways to help local municipalities deal with the myriad of issues that affect their citizenry. IOLA funding has provided a stable source of funds for agencies that do the important work in a variety of areas. At the Legal Aid Society of Rochester, that includes domestic violence and family law representation, housing, immigration, and youth advocacy. Finding a way to ensure that IOLA does not fall victim to the hard economic times of the state is critical. And finding a way to ensure that a systemic and steady stream of funding for legal services in the future is equally critical. As an elected official facing the City of Rochester's own fiscal challenges, I know firsthand that choices have to be made. What to fund, what to cut, and what can we do differently with the funding that we have. As an elected body, we must ensure that the choices we make are the ones that will have the most lasting effect and bring the most positive results. We need to ensure that our choices are cost-effective. And frankly, there is no more cost-effective choice than the full and continued funding of civil legal services. I'd like to give you two examples in two areas of law that I'm most familiar with, domestic violence and housing. One of the greatest economic stressors on our community are the devastating effects domestic violence has on all of us. In addition to the direct effect it has on its victims, the tentacles of domestic violence reach wide and far into our community. The American Institute of Domestic Violence estimates that the health-related cost of domestic violence, rape, assault, and homicide is $5.8 billion per year in this country. Of this, $4.1 billion is direct medical and mental health services, and $8.1 billion accounts for the loss of productivity and earnings that results from domestic violence victims not being able to work. 95% of victims experience problems at work due to action by their abusers, and 54% miss entire days of work. These stressors put an additional burden on local and state governments, so it's cost effective to find a way to prevent domestic violence. Studies have shown that the single most important service that can be provided to a victim of domestic violence, the single most important thing that we can do to decrease the likelihood of victims being battered and to eliminate violence, is providing them counsel. Domestic violence is the primary cause of homelessness amongst women and children. Housing discrimination by landlords is a widespread issue for women who are abused. I'm pleased that Monroe County, New York State, and the federal government have acknowledged the importance of domestic violence legal services by providing funding to agencies and programs to provide these services. I'm also pleased that Monroe County, during my last year in the legislature, recognized the connection between domestic violence and homelessness and passed my domestic violence housing rights bill that prohibits discrimination and tenancies in the sale of property on the basis of domestic violence. But all of this seems like a lot that's already being done, particularly in the area of domestic violence, would be insufficient without the funds that are also provided by IOLA. In addition to much of the federal money and state money and VAWA money that comes through us, IOLA is a very large funder of domestic violence legal services. We have to ensure that all the funding continues and that it is the most flexible funding we can possibly provide. Domestic violence attorneys need to be able to represent their clients not only to obtain orders of protection, but to obtain divorces with economic relief that ensures that adequate awards of maintenance are made, that adequate awards of child support are made, that housing needs are met, that the underlying issues that can impact on a victim's ability to return to work and stay in their community are dealt with. Another area where the cost of funding for legal services is outweighed by the benefit it provides is in homeless and housing. According to the National Alliance to End Homelessness, you measure the cost of homelessness by the increased costs among the homeless for medical treatment, emergency shelter, prison, and decreased productivity. The most basic way to prevent homelessness is to stop it from the beginning. Providing attorneys to prevent immediate eviction, helping to prevent foreclosures, helping people repair their credit, and ensuring that those who are entitled to benefits obtain those benefits goes a long way in preventing homelessness to begin with. It is far less expensive to prevent homelessness than it is to take care of the homeless. And I think, as a city leader, I've seen initiatives, requirements that we need to ensure that homeless are cared for, that I think if money had been spent at the front end to ensure that they didn't become homeless, much less money would have been spent. The loss of funding provided by IOLA would be profound, not only to the individual clients, but to the communities across the state. Keeping IOLA at a hold harmless funding level until the fiscal climate improves is crucial, and assisting in the construction of a long-term solution and a steady stream of funding is equally important. We cannot afford to lose the valuable resource IOLA provides, and we cannot afford to lose the valuable resources our legal services partners provide to this community. Thank you for your time today. I'm happy to answer any questions if you have any.
Thank you, Ms.
Ms. Palumbo.
Thank you.
Senator Volko, do you have any questions or comments?
We're happy to have you here from Rochester very much. I could say to you that we will do everything we can to maintain the funding level for IOLA. I don't think I have to tell you that we're under a lot of criticism because we didn't do more in the so-called DRP, which was a mid-year. You have to imagine, and one of the few people that were in Albany when we did the only other mid-year cuts and created one of the greatest chaotic situations I've ever seen in my career, I can only say to you that there was an attempt, there was a suggestion that we make cuts to IOLA then. Mm-hmm. And for the most part, those cuts, as I say, were rejected. But it is not going to be easy, but I think Ruth would agree with me and Bill and that we'll do our best.
I appreciate that. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Palumbo.
Thank you.
I know I'm going to pronounce this incorrectly, and he's probably used to it. Is it Anthony Schigel?
That's very close.
How close?
The simplified pronunciation is Siegel.
Uh-huh. Okay. That's cheating, Dale.
Senator Volker, my wife is Polish. Right?
For those of you who don't see his name, it has C's and G and Z's, and so I was going to say Siegel, but I said that's cheating. But Professor Anthony Siegel is the attorney, clinical instructor, and professor at the University of Buffalo Law School. Also joining him is Melinda Desair. Did I do that one right at least? Okay. Desair. Partner from Damon and Moray. And David L. Edmonds, Jr., partner with Phillips Lytell.
David Edmonds is not here yet, so we're hoping that he'll be here soon. And okay. Still working.
All right. Okay. No, he is planning. We'll try. We've been moving along pretty well, so we probably can. Thank you very much. I have to step out for one moment, but do you have written testimonies, please?
Yes.
Great.
Would you like me to start?
Why don't you start?
Yes. Sure.
Sure.
Good afternoon. My name is Melinda Desair. I am and have been a partner of Damon & Morey LLP since 1986. I am a former director of the Bar Association of Erie County. I currently serve as a board member for Duval College and for the Volunteer Lawyers Project. Volunteer Lawyers Project is one of the beneficiaries of IOLA funding. I would like to thank you, Senator Volker. I didn't realize you would be here. And the senators that have convened these hearings and calling attention to the IOLA crisis and the impact that it could have on low-income New Yorkers who need civil legal services. Today, I'm going to start by providing an overview of the services provided through Volunteer Lawyers Project, where I'm a board member. I strongly believe that this method of providing civil legal services to low-income New Yorkers is one that deserves continued funding through IOLA and other resources. Second, I will attempt to demonstrate the significant return realized on the investment in these services by using my law firm's experience as an example. Third, I will discuss the continuing need for these services, especially in today's economic climate. and explore some of the negative consequences that could result if services are not funded. Finally, I will suggest that you continue to find ways to continue to fund for these services. First, the Role of Volunteer Lawyers Project. The Erie County Bar Association Volunteer Lawyers Project is a not-for-profit corporation that provides legal services to low-income individuals and small not-for-profit groups, primarily in Erie County. Volunteer Lawyers Project, which is often referred to as VLP, provides its services by screening low-income individuals and not-for-profit groups for appropriate case type and income guidelines. VLP then recruits, trains, coordinates, and assists attorneys who voluntarily, yes, voluntarily and without charge, represent the screened clients on a pro bono or free basis. The volunteer lawyers recruited by VLP represent clients in a variety of civil matters, such as women who are victims of domestic violence, tenants who are in eviction proceedings trying to avoid homelessness, individuals who have lost their jobs and are seeking to obtain unemployment benefits, families affected by HIV, and homeowners facing foreclosure who might otherwise be rendered homeless. The return on investment. VLP operates with very minimal overhead. However, the value of legal services provided is significant. My law firm, Damon & Morey LLP, has been a consistent supporter and provider of volunteer legal services through VLP since I was an associate, and that's quite a while ago now, when I and my coworkers began to volunteer to handle cases assigned through VLP. In the last 3 years, our firm's commitment and contribution of volunteer services has grown steadily. We have increased the number of timekeepers who have contributed services, the number of hours contributed, and the value of the free legal services we have provided to low-income individuals who have been screened through the VLP process. The statistics are set forth in my distribution, but for our last 3 fiscal years, that end on September 30th, the timekeepers have gone from 11 to 21 to 30 who have contributed voluntary time. The number of hours has increased from 267 to over 645, and the value of services has gone from under $44,000 to over $120,000. However, Damon and Morey's contribution of free legal services to VLP is a small fraction of services provided by volunteer attorneys through VLP. The relevant statistics are also set forth in my paper, but as you can see, the cases that VLP has referred have been increasing, and our percentage, the percentage of new cases that we have taken on, have been between 3% and 4%. So we contribute a small portion of the services that are contributed through VLP. Therefore, a modest investment made in an organization like VLP through IOLA generates a huge return on that investment with regard to the actual value of legal services voluntarily provided. Clearly, this type of organization must continue to be a part of the manner in which civil legal services are provided to low-income New Yorkers. However, we all recognize the needs are too great to rely solely on volunteer services to meet the need. A few words about the types of cases that we've been involved in. They've been quite diverse, and they have benefited not only the represented individuals, but their families, our community, and state and local taxpayers. One of our attorneys handled the contested guardianship of a disabled child who turned 18. The adopted father had been incarcerated for many years for sexually abusing children. We successfully proved that the adoptive mother was the only one who should remain guardian, thus reducing the possibility of a continued cycle for abuse and incarceration. Our attorneys have also handled a number of asylum and refugee cases. In one situation, we represented a Christian from Chad. He had been detained in an immigration holding center in Batavia for over 4 years at a significant cost to taxpayers. He believed he would be executed in his home country if he returned because he was active in a group that protested against government discrimination against minority groups, including Christians. Through our efforts, he was properly granted asylum. He now uses his university degree in biology to work as a lab technician in Roswell Park Cancer Institute and is in the process of applying to school to become a registered nurse, a field in which there is a significant shortage in this area. Damon Moore attorneys have also handled dozens of foreclosure actions in the past several years. According to a November 12, 2009 editorial in the New York Times, another surge in foreclosures is expected to occur in 2010. According to the Empire Justice Center, minorities are hardest hit by such foreclosures, and for every foreclosure, neighboring homes lose property value, causing a decrease in property tax revenue and a corresponding increase in rental costs and the tax rates of others. According to an article referenced on Reuters.com titled Cities Grapple with a Surge in Abandoned Homes, which was dated March 25, 2008, Buffalo is plagued by about 10,000 vacant homes and buildings. Foreclosures cost the city approximately $1 million in demolition work and another $1 million in nuisance costs, including police patrols, boarding up the buildings, and the social toll on the community. In fact, Buffalo has found several homicide victims, dog fighting, and drug dealing in its abandoned structures. A Neighborhood Works America August 2008 report outlined numerous ways that foreclosures impact communities, including increased crime, reduced property values, smaller tax base, stress and instability on families and children, displaced residents struggling to find shelter, increased homelessness, and neighborhood blight. The most significant impact is frequently upon African Americans and Hispanics. Civil legal service providers face a stark reality. As the economic crisis deepens, more and more clients come to their doors in need of help. The clients have lost their jobs, they've lost their health benefits, they've lost their disability insurance. They are in foreclosure or they are being evicted. They can't afford a lawyer, but they need help. Yet, in this time of crisis, state funding for legal services has been impacted. Before the economic downturn and before state funding cuts, an estimated 80,000 of low-income New Yorkers' civil legal needs went unmet. Without immediate intervention, that dismal number will continue to climb. As more and more people have lost their jobs, increasing numbers now qualify financially for the VLP services I discussed. In fact, people who have had middle-class income for the past 10 or 20 years are now coming to VLP for help because they have been laid off from their job and cannot make ends meet, so they can't pay for their mortgage or their rent. They cannot pay their credit card bills or their utility bills. Their world's collapsing around them, and they're looking to programs like VLP to provide whatever legal help it can to get them the unemployment benefits, keep them from becoming homeless, and forestall collection agents. The need is great, and it is diverse. Organizations like VLP are part of the solution, but they cannot meet the entire need. The benefits of investing in legal services for the poor transcends the direct value of services provided. The absence of those services strain other taxpayer resources provided to displaced homeowners or their neighbors. In short, these services are necessary to prevent additional problems and drains on taxpayer dollars and services. It's critical that a mechanism be developed to stabilize funding for civil legal aid services such as VLP. To have funding subject to volatile interest rates means that resources are tightest when they are needed the most. I applaud the Office of Court Administration for including $15 million in their budget to help bail out IOLA in the next year. Senators, I do urge you to enact whatever legislation is necessary to fund that $15 million. It's my understanding that the Pennsylvania Supreme Court recently approved a $25 increase in the attorney registration fee, with the increase dedicated to low-income legal services. Not an unreasonable change. In June, the New Jersey Senate, I understand, voted to impose a temporary $300 fee on lenders each time they foreclose on a property. The proceeds are going to legal services for low-income individuals in the state. This could also be considered to offset the loss of IOLA funds while interest rates remain low and foreclosures are high. This type of scheme has the additional benefit of not serving as a block to low and moderate income people in their attempts to obtain access to the judicial system. Clearly, stabilizing resources to ensure that dollars are available in times of high need is appropriate and necessary. Thank you for your time and your commitment to ensuring access to justice for low-income New Yorkers with benefits for all New Yorkers.
Thank you. Before our next speaker, our third speaker, Mr. David L. Edmonds, Jr., has joined us.
Good afternoon.
Thank you. Professor Siegel.
Thank you. good afternoon. My name is Anthony Siegel. I am a professor here at the University of Buffalo Law School, SUNY. I want to thank the committee for providing me with this opportunity to address the issue of what is the most efficient and effective structure in which to distribute and administer civil legal services funding in New York State. I was a civil legal services attorney for 5 years at the beginning of my career. Since 1983, I've supervised a law school clinical program that works closely with legal services for the elderly, disabled, or disadvantaged of Western New York, an Older American Act and IOLA-funded program in downtown Buffalo. Additionally, I have served on the board of directors for two civil legal services programs, serving for a total of 20 years. In short, I have been a close observer of the way legal services are provided in New York for more than 30 years. My conclusion? Civil legal services need a consistent source of unrestricted funds in order to maximize the value derived from that investment. A dedicated fund from either the federal or state government, or both, may be the only way to close the very significant and destructive gap in access to justice. Our model for providing civil legal services relies very heavily on local programs staffed by dedicated full-time salaried attorneys, paralegals, and support personnel. These local programs include legal services for the elderly, neighborhood legal services, the Legal Aid Bureau, and others. Their advocates can develop an expertise on the incredibly complicated public benefit programs such as Medicaid, food stamps, temporary and disability assistance, and other areas of legal need. Within the realm of public benefits, for example, there are so many categorical programs, each with its own procedures and policies, that applying for and continuing to receive benefits is, at a minimum, challenging and often downright impossible for a layperson. The Civil Legal Services Program personnel help to correct individual problems and ensure that individuals actually receive the benefits intended by the legislature when you created these programs. Additionally, the continued participation of these advocates in the administrative process serves as an important quality control function. Their job is to review and test whether the local districts are complying with federal and state law. There is a great value associated in this accumulated knowledge within these public interest law offices. From the client's point of view, the dignity of being able to navigate the system and feel that your side of the story has been heard is priceless. With limited access to legal services, these goals cannot be achieved. The funding for civil legal services programs has changed dramatically over the years. And these changes have, in my opinion, reduced the value of the funding received by the programs. When I was a legal services attorney, the programs typically had one or two primary funding sources. These provided unrestricted funds, that is, funding that was allocated within the program based on a set of priorities set through a public process. The funding was relatively constant over the years. Today, programs such as Legal Services for the Elderly or Neighborhood Legal Services may have 30 or 40 different funding sources, each source with their own set of priorities. The grant cycles from these sources can be as short as 1 year. Each grant imposes a significant set of administrative costs. The program must identify the sources, complete the application, determine how to accomplish the goals, and then document and report that achievement. One of the results of this is that program advocates are juggled from line to line, problem area to problem area, all driven by fluctuating funding. This system is inefficient, both in terms of the administrative costs, but also in the less than ideal use of the skills and knowledge of the advocates. Most critically, as staff time and administrative time are stretched thin to cover a variety of projects, the core basic services often suffer. Private attorneys supplement the services provided by the field programs. In a variety of ways, attorneys in private practice help to close the service gap through both informal and formal pro bono efforts. These attorneys are to be commended for their efforts. They bring in new energy, ideas, and approaches to resolving civil legal problems. However, as a member of the 8th Judicial District Pro Bono Committee, I am painfully aware of the limitations on pro bono services in closing the gap in access to legal services. While the state and local bar associations and such programs as Volunteer Lawyers Program and the Pro Bono Committee must keep up their efforts, they will be only a rather small part of the solution. I wish I could give you the magic bullet for eliminating the incredible gap in access to legal services between the have-a-lots and the have-nots. IOLA is a great idea and has worked well for many years. However, the flaws in relying on that program to provide a dedicated stream of unrestricted funding are now quite obvious. We could supplant that with other state-level sources, such as a CPRE fund, where class action damages that cannot realistically be paid to individual class members are directed to civil legal services programs. Ultimately, I think we will have to face the fact that providing some level of access to justice is a basic societal obligation and has to be funded as such. A dedicated source of funding, well above that currently provided from either the state or federal government or both, may be the only long-term solution. Thank you. That concludes my comments.
Good afternoon. My name is David Edmonds. I'm an attorney with the Phillips Lytle Law Firm. I am a former president of the Bar Association of Erie County, a former president of the Minority Bar Association of Western New York, and a vice president of the New York State Bar Association for this judicial district. I'm also a former member of the Board of Directors of the Erie County Bar Association's Volunteer Lawyers Project. I'm most proud to say that I began my legal career as a Reginald Heber Smith Community Law Fellow at Neighborhood Legal Services. I would like to thank Senators Hassell-Thompson and Sampson for their support of civil legal services and their leadership that they have demonstrated in calling these hearings regarding the potential crisis for IOLA funding and the future of civil legal services. I also want to thank the other senators from the Western New York delegation for their continuing support as well. Unfortunately, due to these economic crisis that we are facing, New York State has been harshly hit by the dramatic loss of revenues with respect to the IOLA fund. At this point, the fund, which has distributed over $31 million for the past 15-month grant cycle in 2008, will only have $6.5 million to distribute in the year 2010. Unquestionably, these hearings are needed to initiate and raise the dialogue level throughout New York State as to how to stabilize funding for indigent legal services. Today I speak on behalf of the Minority Bar Association as well as myself. My remarks will focus on the first of the select issues under consideration, that being how are present economic conditions affecting the demand for civil legal services. My colleagues have done an outstanding job in giving you examples with respect to what programs are doing in terms of the day-to-day aspect of trying to address this situation. So I would like to take a different approach, perhaps a community approach, in addressing three points. First, a brief overview of the critical nature of poverty in Buffalo and Western New York. Second, I will address the specific concerns of the membership of the Minority Bar Association. And third, I will make a specific request with respect to increased funding. My goal is to argue that there is indeed a demonstrated need for this funding. I've been given permission by the Office of the Mayor of the City of Buffalo to highlight some of the significant findings of a document released last year called the Buffalo Poverty Reduction Blueprint. It's an 80-page document prepared after months of talking with individuals, organizations, and various other entities engaged in the battle to combat poverty in Western New York. Buffalo's poor, like the rest of New York's poor, are indeed suffering the brunt of the recession in lost jobs, lost homes, lost income, and in too many cases, lost hope. The precipitous drop in IOLA funding comes at a time, I should say, when legal help for the poor is needed most. And I must emphasize, a solution must be found. According to 2007 U.S. Census American Communities Studies Survey, Buffalo is the third poorest large city in the United States, with a 28.7% or nearly a third of its adult population living below the poverty line. Given the current economic climate with continuing job losses and increasing unemployment rates, there is a concern that even a new class of families will emerge that will live in low-income situations in addition to those already deeply rooted in poverty for decades. So without a doubt, there is a demonstrated need for increased funding for civil legal services organizations. I'll take a minute and just give you some specific numbers. In terms of the proportion of citizens living below the poverty line, in 2007, Buffalo was surpassed only by Detroit, Michigan, and Cleveland, Ohio. And the recent data from the U.S. Census Bureau places Buffalo as the nation's third poorest city. However, the report highlights that poverty is now a regional problem. The report states that while there is a perception that poverty is an issue for the city, but not for the region, census data indicates that poverty is also growing in Erie County. Specifically, the number of county residents in poverty increased from 115,600 in 1990 to 123,800 in 2007, yielding a corresponding increase in the poverty rate for Erie County from 12% to 14%. Approximately 8,000 children in the city of Buffalo, 5 years of age or younger, are being raised in a family living below the federal poverty line. Most alarming, 42% of all children under the age of 17 live in poverty. Female heads of household are the highest group in poverty and the slowest to move out. The poverty rate for single female-headed households in Buffalo is 57%. Each year, over 3,700 properties in Buffalo face potential tax foreclosure for non-payment of City of Buffalo taxes and fees. There are no easy or quick silver bullet solutions to poverty. However, increased funding for IOLA is one essential step in the right direction. As I've indicated, I am a past president of the Minority Bar Association of Western New York, and I've been asked by President Jessica Lazarine to make remarks today on behalf of the association in support of the provision of legal services to indigent persons affected by foreclosure, eviction, domestic violence, unemployment, disability, and other matters affecting family stability and quality of life. President Lazzarine has asked me to advise you that as a group, the Minority Bar Association encourages you, our elected officials, to pass legislation that would allow the Office of Court Administration to sustain IOLA in the year 2010 with the funds that the Office of Court Administration has already set aside. The association believes that this stable funding is vital and must be found within the state's budget to ensure that underrepresented and low-income populations of our city and county have access to legal services so that their livelihood, parental rights, and housing situations are not in jeopardy. Many of our association members are civil service providers, judges, magistrates, and we understand the underlying need for civil legal services organizations in this community. Many of our members have gained their legal training and experience from working with these organizations. It is our civil legal services organizations that provide mentoring programs, continuing legal education programs, and a helping hand when one of our lawyers agrees to expand their practice and handle a case for someone in need. Many of our association members who are in private practice donate their time, their facilities, and resources to pro bono civil cases and want to see these current programs funded, sustained, and expanded. Many of our members who are solo practitioners and need to be able to refer civil service cases to civil service providers so that these individual solo practitioners will not be overwhelmed in their desire to assist the low-income and minority populations of our community who cannot afford to retain attorneys and are forced to face quality of life issues on a daily basis on their own. In fact, the Minority Bar Association and many in the area's legal community are devoted to doing whatever we can to increase the opportunities for those in our community to have access to minority attorneys and necessary legal services. So on behalf of the members of the Minority Bar Association of Western New York, I urge you to take the steps that are required to ensure that attorneys who are practicing in civil legal services programs can continue to do so. Funding is needed to maintain service to these organizations to ensure the safety and security of so many in our community. Several years ago, the New York State Bar Association commissioned a statewide study that was released. The New York Legal Study concluded that the poor in New York faced nearly 3 million civil legal services problems in the study year without help. Not more than 14% of their overall need for legal assistance was being met. I submit to you today that there is no reason to believe that things have drastically changed or improved. Core funding for civil legal services in New York is dramatically less now than it was at the time of the study. It doesn't matter whether it's actually 14% or 20% or 25% of the need that is being met. What is clear is that legal services programs and pro bono lawyers are just barely plugging the holes in the dike with the current level of funding, and they have run out of fingers. Current funding needs to be sustained, and new dedicated funding needs to be found. There's a dire need to continue the coordination of these services. More and more public and government programs that focus on addressing the consequences of poverty now require coordinated service planning and delivery. Service coordination is considered a best practice and is essential to ensuring the delivery of civil legal services and making sure that it is in place and stabilized so that low-income families can obtain the help they so desperately need. Law firms such as Phillips Lido, where I work, are committed to continuing doing pro bono work. However, we need the assistance, we need the direction, we need coordination, and that comes from the organized civil legal services community. In conclusion, IOLA, without a doubt, helps low-income people in New York State to obtain the civil legal service assistance they need, affecting their most basic needs on a daily basis: food, shelter, jobs, access to benefits. I submit to you today that there is indeed an overwhelming number of persons eligible for the services of our programs and in need of continued funding to ensure strong coordination between the legal services programs in Western New York, such as neighborhood legal services for the elderly, volunteer legal services. That funding is more critical now than ever. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Edmonds.
Let me just one mention I might in the testimony of Ms. Desiree. You mentioned the Office of Court Administration included $15 million in their budget to help bail out IOLA. That will be in the governor's budget, and the reason is that under the law, he has to submit the judiciary budget just exactly as the judiciary submits it to him. It's up to us to make sure it stays there.
Right.
But
right.
So my point is, we don't need new legislation, but it will be there, and absent a violation, the governor's not going to do that. The second thing I just want to mention to you, and some people said they were a little surprised to see me. You should understand that anything that has to do with criminal justice, I'm on a committee, and I tell you this story that years ago I realized, and I think my good friend Senator or Assemblyman Joe Lentol, who's been chairman of CODES for a long, long time as I have, you cannot really do criminal justice unless you do civil justice. Mm-hmm. I mean, they don't. In fact, it's my contention that there are committees that are looted together: mental health, civil justice, judiciary, obviously. And I'm the senior member of the Judiciary Committee, and I'm the ranker on CODES, and I'm on Ruth's committee. And by the way, she has been a champion of IOLA and for civil justice funding, I want to tell you. And I want to thank her for coming up here in December. There are very few New York City legislators who will come up here in December. I'll tell you that right now. They have this enormous fear of snow burying the entire city. So she certainly should be credited, but thank you so much in part from me for your testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you. Of providers and attorneys and unions in the persons of Richard Lipschick, Teamster Local Union Number 264, Buffalo, representing the staff for legal for the elderly, Marge Gustas, Union Vice President of the Neighborhood Legal Services, and Denitra Williams, Western New York Law Center. Okay. She won't become.
Okay. Who would you like to go first?
Whomever.
Joyce. Sir? All right. Hello, Senator. How are you?
Good.
Senator? I just wanted to thank Senator Hassell-Thompson and Senator Volker for inviting Senator Hassell-Thompson for inviting us to make a statement. And it's nice to see Senator Volker, who we've known for many years. I'm Richard Lipsitz. I'm a business agent for Teamsters Local 264, and I'm the political action coordinator for the Teamsters Joint Council in Western New York. And it's kind of a funny thing, but for the past 12 years, legal services for the elderly, disabled, and disadvantaged of Western New York have been represented by our local union, which is sort of an interesting thing since we generally represent truck drivers and warehouse workers. But we're an unusual local union, and we've branched off and have organized groups. We have an organizer who tried to organize the cheerleaders of the major indoor lacrosse league. So just as a point, and unsuccessfully, But he's an energetic young man, and he also has a social conscience, and our organization does too. And we decided about 12 years ago, maybe 13 now, that I don't recall exactly how it worked, but the attorneys and paralegals at the organization came to us, or we came to them, and voila, we ended up with a labor agreement. And we've been very pleased with them, and for the last 12 years, I've had the privilege of representing them in bargaining. I'm not an attorney. I'm a business agent for the union. And as I said before, I mainly represent truck drivers and warehouse workers. But these folks work very hard, and they do wonderful, wonderful work. And I just wanted to say a few things on their behalf. The staff attorneys and paralegals of this organization perform an outstanding service to the Western New York community. They are dedicated, selfless, and extremely hardworking individuals. It's amazing the amount of hours they put in and the amount of sacrifice that they provide for their clients. They have chosen to work on behalf of the elderly, the disabled, and generally the downtrodden of our community for wages and benefits that by any standard for attorneys are below that which they could make in private practice. I think that's a fair statement. If the funding levels from the interest on lawyer accounts decrease, as is projected, the result of the organization, I think, will be dramatic, and I hope it won't be, but it could be devastating. This is a money question. The management of the legal services is outstanding, and they've done everything they can to keep the organization going, and I want to be very clear on that. Any changes in the labor agreement, wage and benefits issues that have come up only because there were no other choices. But we have faced, and we could face, layoffs from the bargaining unit staff, service reductions, and dislocation of staff from areas that they have very solid, hard-won expertise. If programs are reduced, obviously, if funding rather is reduced, obviously programs that benefit the people who work there, like health care, 401k plans, and wages, are going to be impacted. And in fact, if there are fewer people doing the work, then less service is going to be provided. This isn't complicated stuff. This is what the inevitable outcome will be. So the obvious irony is that the very same economic downturn which has caused this problem also increases the need for the service. This is a paradox which is not an easy one to solve. And we appreciate that. And we also appreciate, by the way, Senator Volker, especially since we've had lots of conversations over the years, we appreciate the impossible conundrum that you find yourself in as senators. We understand that. It's easy for everybody to second-guess what you do based on a recession like we've never seen in our lifetime. But that goes with your territory. My territory is trying to protect the wages and benefits of the people who do this work, and it's tough. So under these circumstances, we're calling upon, we're asking for the crucial involvement of the State Senate in promoting funding for the civil legal services. And we ask you to continue to work hard to do this. We urge you to do all in your power to maintain this funding and all civil legal services funding against erosions which would devastate not just the service provider, the service itself, but the men and women who actually do the work day to day, make a living doing it. That's my statement.
First of all, Senator Hassell-Thompson, thank you so much for not referring to me as Marge Gustas. It's a bane that I have lived with since I've married 30 years ago. And Senator Volker, I anxiously anticipated your involvement here ever since I could look in the windows of your office on Broadway. I used to live right across the street from where you had your Broadway office. So I had anticipated that you would be here, and was very thankful when I saw you walk in the door. Senators, mine, yes, yes, yes. All right, is this mic on? Yeah, it is. Okay. Senators, my name is Marge Gustas, and I'm a paralegal. Actually, I've been given, I see, a nice promotion to both an attorney and the vice president of the union, neither of which I am. I'm a paralegal at Neighborhood Legal Services, located here in Western New York. I want to thank you for allowing me this opportunity to address such an important issue as the loss of IOLA funding on civil legal services. I've been employed by NLS for 20 years as of November 2009. During that time, I've seen many good times, but also many trying times. None of those trying times brought with them the devastation that will be witnessed by the loss of IOLA monies. I'm speaking to you as a union officer of the Buffalo Organization of Legal Services Workers. Our union represents NLS workers in Buffalo, Niagara Falls, and Oak Orchard, our Batavia office. This is approximately 60 employees. These three offices cover five of the western New York counties, Erie, Niagara Falls, Wyoming, Orleans, and Genesee. Wyoming, Orleans, and Genesee are predominantly rural counties. Erie and Niagara Falls include areas of significant urban blight and decay brought about by a historical loss of jobs and resources to these areas. Jobs that were once the spending money of the high school junior are now the mainstay for many of our working poor. Our communities request for food and heating subsidies, medical assistance, adequate housing, and the alike are not the requests of the lazy. Rather, they are the pleas of those individuals who long ago, as the dust and smoke from our factories wafted away, swallowed their pride and continued to hope for better times. Presently, their children and grandchildren continue to do so. However, good times still have not reached Western New York. To whom will these individuals turn when their request for simple sustenance, care, and shelter is denied, discontinued, or simply ignored? NLS's 2008 budget documents IOLA funds of $700,000. This loss of substantial funding will mean a real prospect of the loss of almost 11 jobs. That is about one-fifth of our workforce. With such a significant drop in manpower hours, how will we decide the number of cases where we can adequately and ethically assist individuals in need? In 2008, NLS took in 7,000 cases. The loss of 11 people will translate into the reduction of services to roughly 1,400 to 1,500 individuals and families. This is over and above the number turned away. That loss will affect people like one of our older female clients with schizophrenia, who is not just capable of getting through the public assistance application on her own. Constant denials took their toll until she received services through our public benefits unit. There, she not only was assisted in successfully submitting her application, but was also awarded back benefits. What about our client who lost her job due to renal disease? She had six children, four of whom had disabilities. Due to her illness, she was hospitalized very often, and get this, during one such hospitalization, she was evicted. NLS represented her at her fair hearing and was not only able to assist her with an application for public assistance, but also able to get her retroactive relief, permanent housing, and assistance with transportation for one of her children so he could continue going to school while they were living in a shelter. Or consider the result of one of our attorneys who successfully represented individuals who are recipients of both Medicaid and Medicare. One small segment of this population, those with the most advanced physical conditions, were caught between these two funding sources. While bureaucracies stood their ground, your constituents remained captive to decrepit or inappropriate medical devices, causing them more harm than good. Their NLS attorney was a strong advocate in convincing the Attorney General that his client, Medicaid, was not only following its own regulations, but also putting its recipients in medical situations that could become additional Medicaid costs borne by the taxpayer. Therefore, for the good of our community, for the continued vitality of civil legal services, our union is requesting that you appropriate permanent funding to maintain a consistent allocation of IOLA funds, so that we can continue to be strong advocates for those who need us. And I thank you again.
Richard, just let me just say that I've known Richard for many, many years. He's always scared me because he's when people are brighter than I am and are not lawyers, it really frightens me. But by the way, I just want to say one thing to both of you. I don't know if you read in today's
paper.
For
re-election?
No. That's my counsel. Just one thing, I read in the paper today that the recession is over, according to the Buffalo News. Weren't you happy about that?
It's going to make my job a lot easier.
I know that. And so it shouldn't be any problem for us to take care of IOLA since the recession is over. I don't know where that came from.
It's a bizarre story.
Yeah. Okay. Well, anyways.
Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Edmonds, did you have a prepared speech?
Yes. My statement?
Yes, your statement.
I have.
Great.
Oh, good.
Okay,
thank you.
Fine.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Nice to see you.
Okay, good to
and
see
thank
you.
Thank you again. Our next group is the Bar Association panel and civic groups in the persons of Robert Convisor, who is President of Erie County Bar Association, Susan Schultz Lackluck, President-elect of the Monroe County Bar Association, and Lenore Banks, Judiciary Chair of the League of Women Voters in New York State. Okay. All right. Okay. Do you anticipate that he will be here?
Yes, I do, Senator.
Okay. All right. Okay. Hopefully before
we'll move on.
We dismiss. Okay.
Thank you.
Ladies? Good afternoon. Okay. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Susan Schultz LaLuc, and I'm a partner at the law firm of Boyle & Brown in Rochester, and I'm also president-elect of the Monroe County Bar Association. I'm here on behalf of Harold Curlin, current president of the MCBA, who was unable to attend today, and the over 2,200 members of Monroe County Bar Association in the greater Rochester area. I want to first of all thank you for holding these hearings on a matter of such critical importance to our community, and thank you for the support that you've provided to legal services in the past. I'd like to address the ongoing and increasing need for civil legal services in the greater Rochester area and throughout New York State. The downturn in our economy has had a serious impact on the lawyers of our Bar Association and their clients, but those most severely impacted by the current economic crisis are those who had the least to begin with, as well as the countless individuals and families who've become unemployed, causing not only lost jobs and lost income, but an unprecedented increase in bankruptcies, foreclosures, evictions, loss of health insurance, etc. Many previously employed people are now financially insecure. The need for civil legal services has greatly increased for both the poor as well as many of the middle class, even as resources for such services has continued to decline. As reported by the Legal Services Corporation in September 2009, for every client served by an LSC-funded program, at least one person who sought help was turned away due to insufficient resources. While the IOLA Fund was a creative way to provide additional support for civil legal services over the past several decades, plummeting interest rates has caused us to realize that the current patchwork of funding streams is unreliable and has decreased at the very time when the need for services has skyrocketed. Members of the Monroe County Bar and other lawyers throughout New York State provide an incredible amount of pro bono services, and I am very proud to be the member of a profession that is so very generous in their donation of their time and expertise. However, the need is greater than reliance on pro bono services can meet. Nationally, pro bono accounts for roughly one-third of all civil legal assistance provided, according to research published in Private Lawyers and the Public Interest in 2009. Not only is the quantity of pro bono services insufficient to meet the growing needs, but our lawyers need the services of legal service providers to help screen clients and teach private lawyers how to appropriately provide legal services more effectively. As a business attorney and a business owner, I am always focused on seeking out the most cost-effective solutions, trying to get the most bang for my buck for both my law practice and my business clients. As a taxpayer, I also want the government to provide cost-effective services to our citizens. During this holiday season, we're all familiar with the classic movie, It's a Wonderful Life. It's a favorite movie that has endured, not just because it is a feel-good movie, but because I think there is an essential truth about the premise of the movie that resonates with us. That fundamental truth is that George Bailey was able to transform a town from Pottersville to Bedford Falls by providing a little bit of assistance to individuals and families at critical times in their lives. In his famous speech to the bank board, he says, "Now hold on, Mr. Potter. You're right when you say my father was no businessman, but he did help a few people get out of your slums. Mr. Potter, and what's wrong with that? Why, here, you're all businessmen here. Doesn't it make them better citizens? Doesn't it make them better customers? Just remember this, Mr. Potter. This rabble you're talking about, they do most of the working and paying and living and dying in this community." George Bailey loaned money people so that they could buy houses instead of living in overpriced rented slums. And he helped them so they could send their kids to school to get education and training for better jobs. Providing legal services to help families overcome critical issues at turning points in their lives can be transformative and have huge long-term positive impact. Of course, we can all feel good when we provide legal services to the economically disadvantaged, but it's more than just doing the right thing. It's also about doing the smart thing. Providing civil legal services to help struggling families stabilize their finances by helping them get disability benefits and unemployment insurance allows them to pay bills, make purchases, and contribute to the local tax base. Providing legal services to prevent a neighbor's foreclosure avoids vacant houses and declining values for the entire community. Helping families obtain needed medical services keeps them healthy and productive citizens. Preventing eviction and helping clients get food stamps gives the children of our community a roof over their heads and food in their stomachs so they can attend and succeed in school and become the next generation of taxpaying citizens instead of burdening our communities with a greater need for prisons and social services. It's not just about doing right and feeling good. Providing stable financing for legal services makes good economic sense for the community. Therefore, I urge you to not only address the immediate and urgent need for the appropriation of $15 million for civil legal services, but also to create a permanent access to justice fund in the state budget so that ongoing critical legal needs of our most vulnerable citizens will be able to be met in ways that will provide financial stability and long-term benefits to communities throughout New York State. I thank you for your time and dedication to this very important issue.
Good afternoon, members of the Senate Committee and the public. I am Lenore Banks, Judicial Specialist for the League of Women Voters of New York State. Thank you for the opportunity to comment on IOLA and the future of civil legal services in New York State. The League of Women Voters of New York State is a nonpartisan political membership organization that encourages informed and active participation in government, works to increase understanding of major public policy issues, and influences public policy through education and advocacy. The League has over 50 local leagues statewide. It is celebrating its 90th anniversary, and its current membership includes both men and women. That's important to note. For three decades, the League is actively engaged in support of the state's role in the funding of civil legal services for the most vulnerable of our population. We supported the establishment of IOLA in 1983, supported mandatory participation in 1988, and advocated for the establishment of the Disabled Advocacy Program and the Homeless Intervention Program. I have served on the Board of Neighborhood Legal Services here in Erie County for a dozen years in the 1980s and 1990s, so I am speaking from firsthand experience. We in the League appreciate the efforts of the Senate, the Assembly, and the Office of Court Administration to fill the gap left in IOLA funding due to this economic crisis. However, New York State legal service providers desperately need consistent and secure funding to effectively and efficiently meet the needs of the poor. We have become convinced of the need for a permanent funding source or sources. More than a decade ago, in May 1998, the legal services report to the chief judge stated, and I quote, "In recent times, only a fraction of the legal needs of the poor have been met, and the resources available to meet those needs have shrunk, while the number of persons in need has grown," end quote. That was over a decade ago, and today the funding situation is even worse. With interest rates at a historic low, it is estimated that funds generated through IOLA will decrease 47% to 75%. The IOLA funds are drying up just when the needs of the poor for legal services are increasing. They need legal assistance to access their unemployment insurance benefits, to stave off an eviction or foreclosure, to secure desperately needed food stamps, public assistance, and Medicaid, not to mention the need for assistance with a whole range of family problems, including including domestic violence, child custody, visitation, and support. What we need is, what we found is these services work. They work as a stabilizing force for the benefit of families and for the benefit of the state. The intervention of legal services helps to ensure that families receive the economic, medical, housing, educational, and social support benefits to which they are entitled, thereby minimizing physical and social upheaval and physical and psychological violence. By working with local social service offices, legal services can ensure that rent payments flow appropriately to landlords, avoiding evictions and costly shelter stays. By representing those who have been inappropriately denied or terminated from federal disability benefits, legal services is able to provide financial stability to low-income families while at the same time helping to avoid unnecessary state welfare costs. By helping young mothers to secure the child support to which their children are entitled, legal services is able to provide some measure of economic security and, again, to help the family avoid the need for public assistance. According to Ann Erickson, president and CEO of Empire Justice Center, and I quote, "Civil legal services are incredibly effective at working with families to keep them in their homes by avoiding eviction or foreclosure, many of whom would have had nowhere to turn but a local homeless shelter. Another way in which civil legal service programs provide substantial and immediate savings to state and local government is by working with families to stabilize their circumstances. For every child, a legal services program is able to help keep out the foster care system. Government will save an average of $18,200 at a bare minimum." How have other states responded to the IOLA crisis? Modern courts and the Empire Justice Center are pursuing analyses of other states' efforts to address the underfunding of civil legal services in times of economic turndown. We look forward to their continuing research for applicability to New York State. The common elements we discerned in their analyses of Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, and California were the establishment of a permanent funding source based on increases in court fees or court fee surcharges to generate additional revenue. The problem here is to carefully select those fees which do not adversely impact on poor people's access to the courts in the drive to provide representation. We must avoid curtailing access to the court while funding increases access to representation. We do appreciate the current efforts of the Senate and Assembly to provide civil legal services with money from the general fund and the Office of Court Administration's $15 billion allocated in the next budget. However, yearly battles over the budget do not provide the level of stability that a permanent funding source would provide. Thank you for this opportunity to express our views.
That means me. Thank you.
Yes.
Good afternoon.
Well, I wanted to get the opportunity to introduce you, but you can introduce yourself.
I am Robert Convisar. I am the president of the Bar Association of Erie County. I want to thank the committees for providing us with the opportunity to present testimony today on funding for civil legal services. This issue is very important to me and to the 3,800 members of the Bar Association of Erie County. The financial crisis has hit all parts of New York State hard, and Erie County has been particularly affected. This year, only five counties in New York State had more foreclosure filings in court than Erie County. Every one of those counties is in the New York City area, and one of the counties, Bronx, just barely pushes us out of the top five, even though the population in Bronx County is 52% larger than here in Erie County. This economic climate has resulted in a huge demand for legal services. Poor people start out poor, they continue to be poor, and they're made poorer by a bad economy. As you know, Senators, ours is an adversarial system, and although the judiciary tries to help the unrepresented with procedural issues, they're required and they must and they do remain neutral when judging disputes. People need effective legal representation when they are in court. We in the Bar Association of Erie County see access to justice for all as a fundamental part of our efforts to promote the public interest. Last year, I am proud to say, members of the Bar Association of Erie County gave unselfishly of their time to handle many pro bono cases for indigent clients. We work constantly with our law firms here in Erie County to increase their participation and the hours that they devote to pro bono work. But the demand for legal services far outstrips the ability of the private bar to provide representation to those who cannot afford counsel. A September 2009 report by the Legal Services Corporation found that for every client funded by an LSC-funded program, at least one person who sought help was turned down because of insufficient resources. One of the largest providers of civil legal services here in Erie County collected statistics for that report and counted the number of people they were forced to turn away for legal services in Erie County for a two-month period. In that two-month period, they turned away 3,250 people at this one organization because that organization did not have the resources, the funds, to serve everyone who was in need and who came for help. Annualized, that represents approximately 19,000 people turned away. That's in Erie County alone. The numbers throughout the state are and must be staggering. Of course, many more indigent people do not even seek legal services because they know that the agencies that provide them are overextended. And because they're overextended, they can't advertise and seek to obtain more and more clients coming because they have to turn more and more away. IOLA funding has played a critical role in supplementing the efforts we have made at the Bar Association of Erie County to provide legal counsel to those who would otherwise be unrepresented. But as you've heard through series of testimonies today and throughout the state, IOLA is vulnerable to fluctuation in interest rates. At the time that funding for legal services is most needed, interest rates can drop and lower the amount of funding available. The result is the loss of millions of dollars in funding for civil legal services. According to its 2008 report, the IOLA Fund awarded grants totaling $25 million. However, grants for the 2010 to 2011 fiscal year are expected to drop to approximately $6.5 million. Unfortunately, New York does not provide a stable funding mechanism for civil legal services. We therefore join with the New York State Bar Association in urging you to, one, create a permanent access to justice fund in the state budget. Two, identify a state-level agency to assume responsibility for administration and oversight of that fund. And three, work with the legal community to ensure that access to justice receives sufficient support, attention, and priority. Senators, we understand that New York State is experiencing an extreme budget crisis. As you wrestle with where funds should be cut and how to best prioritize where state money should go, we trust that you will recognize that fundamental individual rights are at stake whenever someone enters a courtroom. Access to justice for all people is a basic obligation of our society. That obligation cannot be fulfilled, and people cannot have access to justice when they do not have access to attorneys to help them with their cases. Legal services programs for the indigent are an important part of giving the poor access to justice in our society. When you consider the cost of supplementing the expected IOLA shortfall this year, we also hope that you will take note of the testimony given at the New York City hearings by Benito Romano, the chair of the Board of Trustees of the IOLA Fund, when he reported that in 2008, IOLA funds helped 12,514 attorneys donate pro bono services, providing 416,000 hours of free legal service valued at over $83 million. As Mr. Romano said in his testimony, in 2008, the clients served by IOLA grantees obtained nearly $250 million in wrongfully denied federal benefits, child support, alimony, and affirmative judgments. Helping the IOLA Fund overcome the shortfall this year does have a cost, but there are also huge costs in failing to supplement IOLA that are borne by those least able to do so. If that money could not be recovered by those folks, they would be $250 million more disadvantaged and have lost access to what the law says they rightfully are theirs to be had. I therefore urge you to supplement the IOLA shortfall and to help legal services programs in New York State attain consistent and fair funding as we move forward. This will be very difficult for you, and you have a very difficult job ahead. But we thank you for the time and the attention you are giving to this important topic at this very important time of the year. Thank you.
Thank you. If each of you that has prepared statement, we'd appreciate copies.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Any questions, Senator? Nope. They tell me I run a tight ship in Albany. I have to tell you that it's now 2 o'clock. And this last panel was supposed to come on at 3:15, so we've had a good tailwind up here in Buffalo today. But a lot of that is to credit to each of the presenters, because while they have tried very hard to paint the picture, they've done it very succinctly, and that's important. And they've tried not to repeat everything that has already been said, but to reinforce just the criticalness and the importance. Our final panel today will consist of Mr. Brian Hetherington, Chief Counsel for the Empire Justice Center, and Ken Perry, the Executive Director of Legal Assistance of Western New York.
Thank you, Senator. Good afternoon, and thank you. And I've provided copies of my testimony to your aid there. Before I make my substantive remarks, I do want to also thank you, Senator Volker, for being here today. Hello, JR. And Senator Hassell-Thompson for traveling all around the state and convening these hearings. It's very much appreciated. I wanted to also thank the Senate for the allocation this year of funding for civil legal services generally throughout New York State. I know it's the first time in the history of the state that the Senate has done that, and the civil legal services community truly appreciates that. We appreciate that during the deficit reduction session that funding, as far as I understand, remains uncut, and we very much appreciate that. And also very important to our community is the new loan repayment assistance program for bringing civil legal services attorneys into that loan repayment assistance program. Very, very crucial to our staffs who work with very minimal salaries for attorneys. I am Ken Perry. I'm the Executive Director of Legal Assistance of Western New York. You have in my written testimony some details about the work of our program. Just to lay the scope of the land, we serve 14 counties from my program. We have 7 staffed offices, and their locations are in Bath, Elmira, Geneva, Ithaca, Jamestown, Olean, and Rochester. So it's a pretty far-flung program. I'm also here today speaking on behalf of the Legal Services Funding Alliance, which is the alliance of legal services organizations around New York State outside of the city. The alliance has 20 members. A list of the alliance members and the counties that they serve is attached to the end of my testimony. And together, those 20 organizations cover every county in the state outside of the 5 boroughs in the city. The impact, personally, on my program, I can tell you my board approved our 2010 budget this past Monday, and with regard to IOLA, we were forced to budget a 44% reduction in funding, I believe, is what we did. For my program, that translates into $375,000. In my program, that amount of funding more or less funds the salaries and fringe benefits of 6 full-time attorneys. And 6 full-time attorneys very conservatively estimating number of cases. It means this cut to my program means that 900 fewer households, fewer families in our 14-county service area will be helped at a minimum. It's probably much more than that. The cuts come to a system that is, as you've heard, and I'm not going to talk about it in detail, but it's in my written testimony, is overwhelmed. Mr. Kahnweiser talked about the unable to serve study that Neighborhood Legal Services participated in Buffalo. My program, all 7 offices participated in that as well, and we reported together with the Volunteer Legal Services Project of Monroe County. The details of our unable to serve study are in the testimony. The bottom line was that during that 2-month period, 63% of the people who called us for help who were low income and had cases that fall within our priorities were turned away with no service at all. And on top of that, of the cases that we did take, another 10% of those callers got less service than what they really needed. They got information or advice on what they needed was an attorney standing beside them in court. In terms of the short term, our community is deeply appreciative to Judge Lipman for the decision that he made to include funding help abate the IOLA crisis this coming year in the unified court system budget. And as Senator Volker mentioned, I'm truly hopeful that the Senate and the Assembly and the Governor will keep that there at the end of the day. And that will allow us to manage this crisis in the short term while discussions go on about long-term solutions. In terms of long-term solutions, this is in my I'm not going to read it to you, but basically I speak in support of the creation of an Office for Civil Legal Services, not a freestanding new agency, but an office with staff who is devoted to allocating funding to the civil legal services community and providing oversight to the civil legal services community. And once everyone is on the same page on that, which I hope everybody gets there, the question is where would that office be housed? And in my testimony, I provided some logical places to start looking. One of them, of course, is the unified court system, which passed through money to the civil legal services programs, I think 2 fiscal years ago. Many of the grantees in New York State are grantees of the Division of Criminal Justice Services, with whom we have a working relationship, and many of us also have contracts administered by the Department of State, and there are other options, but basically we need a home, we need a staff, we need a presence, especially when budget decisions are made, and we should probably be in the context of a state agency or the court system. In terms of long-term funding, some of the solutions that have been settled upon in other states were talked about by earlier panelists. A dedicated portion of attorney registration fees going into a fund for legal services is one solution. The same with court filing fees. The New Jersey $300 assessment on filing foreclosures assessed to lenders is another example. And in California, and I think Brian Hetherington will speak to this in more detail, there is an assessment being piloted on judgments that litigants in civil proceedings obtain after their court case is done. So that kind of an assessment on a judgment would not create the access to justice problems that the filing, people who do not support increasing filing fees or dedicating a portion of filing fees would create. One very probably complex and one-time potential source of revenue for New York State for civil legal services that would need to be explored fairly expeditiously if it's going to be pursued is the TANF contingency fund. It's TANF contingency emergency funds that New York State can apply for. There is a 20% match, so that for every new dollar that New York State puts into civil legal services could potentially allow New York State to draw down $4 in federal money. So a $1 million appropriation could potentially result in $5 million coming into legal services programs. This is a fairly complex, much more complex than the other solutions, and it's one time and short term, but could bring in a significant amount of money to help us manage the present crisis until the long-term solutions are settled on. The providers of civil legal services would have to ensure that all of that money, if it's pursued, is used to serve TANF-eligible families. So it is a little complex. In terms of the civil Gideon issue, I'm going to turn it over to Brian, but I do speak in support of that, of a mandatory right to counsel in quality of life cases involving housing, sustenance, safety. And I do reference you in my testimony, you're probably already aware of it, of a report on the right to counsel in quality of life cases that was adopted by the New York State Bar Association's House of Delegates back in November, which provides a framework for how that right to counsel can incrementally be introduced in New York State in a responsible way. And I'm going to stop here. Oh, one last thing you asked about, indicators of legal need. I think obviously the unemployment rate, which is tracked on the Department of Labor website, is an indicator of how many more people will be coming into our doors this coming year. DHCR publishes on its website the numbers of foreclosures broken out by every county in the state as soon as those numbers are able to be compiled. And in my testimony, I did not talk about this, but an important source of information, I think, is Judge Fisher's office. Judge Fisher is the chief administrative judge for the New York City courts, but also has been charged with statewide access to justice issues. And I've heard her speak about the staggering numbers of unrepresented litigants in the court system. I don't have that data in my testimony, and I don't know if it's on their website, but would obviously be available from her office. So I thank you. I thank you for traveling the corners of the state to hold these hearings and appreciate your time.
Good afternoon, Senators. My name is Brian Hetherington, and I'm Chief Counsel of the Empire Justice Center. We're a statewide legal services organization with offices in Rochester, Albany, White Plains, and Central Islip on Long Island. Empire Justice provides support and training to legal services and other community-based organizations. We undertake policy research and analysis, and we engage in legislative and administrative advocacy. We represent low-income individuals as well as classes of New Yorkers in a wide range of poverty law areas, including foreclosure prevention, government benefits, special education, disability, and other civil rights, and many other areas of the law. We would also join our colleague, Mr. Perry, in thanking the senators for coming today and being present and for your support for civil legal services over the past year, and the details of that are all in the testimony, in the written testimony, and I will sort of skip over that. In addition to the traditional consumers of civil legal services, traditionally low-income families and individuals who remain in constant state of financial insecurity, the providers of civil legal services have been inundated by individuals who are now unemployed or whose wages have now been reduced. This new clientele encounters multiple and critical legal problems. They need significant help as a result of their reduced income. Since you've already heard much about the crisis in funding and how civil legal services both achieves successful outcomes for our clients on their most important issues and saves the state and local governments money, I'd like to spend my time discussing the fourth and fifth issues on which you requested testimony at this hearing, the issues that focus on the potential solutions. I want to start with the fifth issue, the question of whether New York should follow California's example and enact a statutory right to counsel in civil cases that involve critical quality of life issues. And I want to put these comments into a context. In addition to maintaining the current funding for civil legal services, we believe that New York should expand the categories of civil cases in which publicly funded legal representation is available. It should do so in a way that low-income people are ensured quality representation. We should not repeat the mistakes that have occurred on the criminal side, where staggering caseloads and the lack of quality standards have led to calls from the chief judge and others for reform of the criminal assigned counsel system. Both the American Bar Association and the New York State Bar Association have endorsed the concept that legal counsel should be available as a matter of right at public expense in those categories of cases where the most basic human needs are at stake. These associations have identified five categories of cases where providing publicly funded counsel is warranted. Cases involving shelter, sustenance, personal safety, health, or child custody. Now the good news. New York already provides publicly funded counsel in two of those five areas. In cases involving child custody and in those involving safety of victims of a domestic violence who need protection from their abusers. So the question really is, should we expand the right to publicly funded counsel to the remaining three critical areas of need? Those states that provide publicly compensated counsel in some of the five critical areas identified by the ABA do so because they understand that it is necessary to achieve just results in cases to have all parties represented in a civil case. They do so so that the justice system can actually deliver justice to all of the parties. They understand that we operate in an adversary system of justice in America. The core premise of that system is that truth, and therefore justice, is going to emerge from the clash of presentation of facts and legal argument by trained attorneys, and that if a party is not represented in that proceeding, that party is at such a profound disadvantage that the justice-seeking function can be completely impaired. The Supreme Court of the United States recognized this truth in the criminal law context in the middle of the last century. As a result of its decisions, beginning with the Gideon versus Wainwright case, all individuals facing criminal charges that can theoretically lead to even a single day of incarceration are guaranteed an attorney to defend them. States, including New York, have come to recognize that there are civil justice matters in which the issues that are faced by the litigants are equally as important, maybe even more important, than the possibility of spending a night in jail, as horrible as that is. Certainly, most of us
all of the parents in the room, I'm sure, would agree with me, that we would prefer to spend a night in jail than to lose the custody of our children. Anybody want to dissent out there? I don't think so. You know, New York responded to that shared belief, and we have enacted a broad right to counsel where parents are threatened with loss of custody of their children, either to the state in child abuse and neglect proceedings or to other parents in ordinary custody proceedings. And in the last couple of years, we've expanded that to Supreme Court and not just family court, because we recognize the importance of the issues at stake. However, there are other areas in the civil justice system in which the rights at stake are of the same degree of importance or greater importance than simply spending a night in jail, but in which counsel is not currently guaranteed, and the current levels of funding for civil legal services leave many facing these harms unrepresented. A prime example is the loss of housing. Don't you think that most of us would prefer to spend a night in jail than to lose our homes? I don't think it matters whether that loss is through mortgage foreclosure or through eviction. The prospect of becoming homeless is a truly catastrophic loss for any family. It is for this reason that the New York State Bar Association has recommended that the right to counsel should next be expanded to cover the loss of housing. In moving to expand the right to counsel, New York could take the next step by adding categories like housing cases or equally important cases like right to access to health care or access to core public benefits that provide the very means to survive for funding when additional state funding becomes available. Providing lawyers in cases involving the most critical legal harms is important to reaching a just result because of the role that lawyers play in the litigation system. We're able to analyze the facts of a case to determine whether our clients have defenses or claims. We gather the documents and interview the witnesses whose testimony might be helpful or even essential to our client. And we present that information to the court or at an administrative hearing under the complex legal rules of evidence. Without those steps in case preparation, there's a huge possibility that an unjust result will be reached because the judge or jury will only hear effectively one side of the controversy. Lawyers can play an equally important role in ensuring just results in the civil justice system, in which virtually all of the civil cases are going to end up with some sort of a settlement. If only one side knows the law, knows what might actually occur if the case is tried, is trained in advocacy skills, it's very hard to reach fair settlements in settlement negotiations. When there are lawyers on both sides, cases can be fairly settled, and judges who oversee this process can be reasonably sure that a just result has been reached because there was no overreaching by one party over another. As a result, many trials are avoided, and the judges can spend their time on those cases that really must be tried, and public funds are saved. While we certainly would want New York to publicly funded counsel for the remaining critical three areas of legal needs, we recognize the difficult financial position of New York State at this time. So now I'm going to turn to the question of how New York should fund civil legal service justice system expansion. It's important to recognize that we face an immediate short-term crisis that's being caused by the over 70% decline in IOLA revenue, and we face a longer-term issue of how we ought to fund the justice system that New York needs and desires and its citizens deserve, a justice system that could actually deliver justice to all of our citizens. We are certainly grateful to Chief Judge Lippman for including a $15 million request to shore up the IOLA fund in the judiciary budget, and we are very grateful to the legislative leaders who have requested that he do so. However, in the short term, it is clear that we need to find a revenue source that will permit additional state funding for civil legal services at a time when general funds for expansion are simply not available because of the fiscal crisis. We believe the one promising approach is the one that has recently been chosen by California in funding its Civil Gideon pilot project. California has imposed a modest filing fee on civil judgments. Therefore, it's only after a litigant wins that the fee is imposed. In that way, the fee does not act as an impediment to access to justice, but rather a user fee on the person who is successful in obtaining justice. Now, New York already imposes surcharges on criminal judgments to carry out public purposes, to fund those purposes. So this approach on the civil side would be consistent with our current practices. The amount of the fee to file a judgment or a settlement in a case should probably differ based on the level of courts in which the case is filed, with lower fees being filed in city, justice, district courts, and in the civil court of the city of New York, and a higher fee being charged in surrogates and Supreme Court. This approach would be consistent with our current practice of charging different fees for cases in our different courts. We note that other states use a variety of other fees to provide funds for access to civil justice, and others today and in the New York City hearings have testified about the potential to use filing fees, motions fees, attorney registration fees, or other miscellaneous fees to fund civil justice. Clearly, it is important to the extent possible to choose revenue streams that will not impair access to justice for both low-income individuals and near-poor individuals. We need to make informed choices about what direction to take, and we believe that a small group, including the Office of Court Administration, should be convened to look at the alternatives and to calculate the amount of revenue that could be reasonably be raised through them so that quality decision-making can occur by those of you charged with the responsibility to figure out what will be the best short and long-term financing choices for New York. To do this, we believe that all funding options have to remain on the table. However, as we move forward, we also believe it's critical to recognize that a litigation fee-based system alone will only help us get through this current IOLA crisis. It will not provide justice for all New Yorkers. Litigation-based fees will never raise sufficient revenue to provide access to justice in all five critical areas of human need identified by the ABA and the New York State Bar Association, nor will they provide adequate support for the general delivery of legal services in areas beyond those five areas, some of which are quite critical and quite desirable. Nor should litigation fees be expected to do so in the long run. All of our citizens is one of the core functions of our government. We spend hundreds of millions of dollars on our civil justice system, but we fall short when it comes to spending on the critical area of representation. New York rightfully did not tie the public funding of counsel to parents facing the loss of their children or to domestic violence victims in need of assistance with orders of protection to a specific fee-based funding source. Instead, we wisely recognized that in order to do justice in cases involving these critical human needs, general state funding would be required, as it is to provide for the other parts of the civil justice system. We do not insist that the other elements of the system, the judges, the clerks, the other court personnel, the heat and light in the courthouses, be funded by user fees, nor do we expect that taxes on health care will fund Medicaid or other critical health services that our population needs. If we wish to live up to the promise of democracy, including the promise of providing liberty and justice for all, we need to develop a longer-term vision that moves beyond fee-based funding. If we believe the expansion of the right to counsel into the remaining critical civil areas is necessary to provide justice for all our citizens, we will need to act when the state comes out of the current fiscal crisis to ensure the general funds are used to expand the right to counsel beyond custody and domestic violence. At the same time, it's also critical that we not lose sight of the need to maintain the alternative revenue sources identified through our current investigation to ensure that the full range of civil legal services, from individual representation in non-mortgage consumer cases to education matters to providing critical training and support to legal services attorneys and systems change advocacy, are preserved and expanded. Thank you very much for the opportunity to testify today. You're welcome.
I've been joined by State Senator Antoine Thompson, and since this is his district, I would not dare let this presentation go today without hearing from Senator Thompson.
Madam Chairwoman, I just want to thank you for your leadership on this subject matter, and also my colleague, Senator Del Volker, as well, for being here, and I'm sure you all have been doing a great job, and I don't want to keep the program going long, but I will just say one thing, that this is a area that I believe is extremely important, and so many people rely on the services that are provided, and you all can be certain that whatever the chairwoman tells me to do in terms of my vote on this issue, I'm right there with her. Thank you, and God bless you.
That's a good segue to the end of our session. First, let me say, in listening to the testimonies today, each of us come to the State Senate having had a life before. And my life before consisted of working with the substance abusing population and working with women who had been substance abusers. And as a part of that, many of the kinds of issues that just go undetected somehow get lost. When I came to the Senate, of course, I did not understand the fancy terminology of IOLA, certainly. But I did understand the necessity for legal services. And part of what becomes important to all of us is that if we really believe that justice is well served, that it must be served equally and to the best of our ability. By doing that, everyone who comes into court should be properly represented. So as we have grappled with this budget and as we go forward, what we're trying to establish is a public policy that says that we do believe in justice, and therefore it is incumbent upon us to have this public discourse and to create the best method possible for funding of a service that is beneficial to all members of this state. It is also incumbent upon us to not fail to recognize the kind of money that IOLA brings to the state and the kind of good services that we have provided and have the potentiality to continue to provide. I appreciate all of you who have come today and who have given testimony, and I certainly appreciate my colleague in the person of Bill Stokowski, who started the morning with us, and with Senator Antoine Thompson, who finished the afternoon with us, but certainly for Senator Volker, who stayed the course. He and I have had a very interesting relationship in the Senate, and you know, we come say, how can the two of you be friends? Somewhere in the middle, we both believe in justice for people, and we both believe in trying to ensure that there is fairness and justice. And so that's where we meet. And in that process, we've been able to be very successful in helping each other to come to some decisions, sometimes to the bane of the existence of our mutual parties. But but I think that that's really what good government is about, and so that I truly appreciate the friendship that he has shown, and certainly by being here with us today and with with Senator Antoine Thompson and Bill Stokowski, what we're attempting to show is that there is an attempt at good government. And no matter what the media tells you, we do work hard at what we do, and we don't always agree. But there are certainly times when we do, and where we do, and where we can find those points of mutual concern and interest where they converge, that's where we try to come out. And I think that these hearings have certainly demonstrated that. And so I thank all of you, and I wish for all of you a very safe return home, but certainly for a marvelous holiday and a healthy and prosperous new year. Thank you very much.